Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. We've received apologies from Mark Griffin this morning, and Marie McNair will be joining us online. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 7, 8 and 9 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the annual report of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman 2022-23 from Rosemary Agnew, who is our Ombudsman, Andrew Sheridan, who's the Head of Improvement Standards and Engagement, and Nikki McLean, who's the Director at the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman. And I'd like to invite Rosemary to make a short opening statement.
Good morning. Thank you. And thank you also for rearranging the timing of this to before Christmas rather than after. I can still just about remember last year at this point now. I don't propose to go through everything that you've already seen in updates and the annual report, other than to say I think for us our main themes are around our broad statutory functions. Obviously, public service complaints, which have their challenges, but at the moment I'd say one of the biggest challenges for us is volumes. We're seeing dramatic increases, even in the last 2 months, of demand and complaints. The Scottish Welfare Fund, which is another area of a very distinct type of function, that's relatively stable in the sense of the numbers coming in, and the challenges there are more about policy and guidance and the unpredictability of the future. The whistleblowing, independent national whistleblowing officer function, I would say we're now, certainly the first year going into the second, seeing it bed down a lot more. We're learning a lot more about the approach to investigation, which is quite different to public service complaints. And then finally, the other area of our work, which is around engagement, communication and complaint standards. That is an area that we've also been working on in respect of child-friendly complaints. And we've done a lot of development work of our function in terms of training, developing a new approach to outreach since lockdown finished. So what we're seeing is four very distinct areas, but the common themes between them are resourcing, capacity and trying to foresee numbers but at the same time build in efficiencies, because we recognise that resourcing is going to be an issue for everyone. Yeah. You will also have had an update from our six-month point, which we found really helpful to do because it will give a sense of progression. And we've even an update on some of those figures that you saw there, because I know you've had a particular interest in the backlog of unallocated complaints that we started last year with. So I think at that point, I'm just going to leave it open for questions and hope that we cover all of these four areas.
Yeah. Great, thanks so much for that introduction. And yeah, absolutely. If we don't ask the right questions for the things you want to get on record, please make sure you do that anyway. So thanks so much for the introduction. And I do want to touch in on, you mentioned in your opening statement around the volumes of complaints received. And I would be interested to learn a bit more from you. You wrote also to us about the unprecedented increase in public service complaint numbers so far in 2023. And I'd be interested to hear if you have a sense of why that is and what the trends that you're observing.
Okay, yeah, what we're seeing by the time we started the current year was numbers creeping up. And by the time we did the six-month update, we were fairly close to where we were pre-COVID. But what we have seen in the last 2 months is the number of public service complaints received has increased by 40%. Now, it's very easy to say, oh, COVID was the factor in all of this. And certainly in 22-23, we were probably seeing the legacy of COVID, in that it disrupted our service, it disrupted our ability to get information from public bodies because their service was certainly disrupted. But I don't think that was necessarily the underlying issue. I think it was the exacerbating one. And services were already under pressure prior to COVID. There were already complaints about waiting times for elective surgery. There were already concerns about the scope or the value or the quality of public services. And I think what COVID did was exacerbate some of those existing issues. But I'd say the two things that have been significantly different have been the double whammy of cost of living and inflation and public expectation. Certainly the cost of living and inflation taken together, they didn't just increase the day-to-day living costs for people, they increased the costs for public bodies in delivering their service. And then with inflation not reducing as quickly as everybody had expected, even when the cost of living started going down slightly, and it's unlikely it will go back to where it was, the spending power of what is left is reducing. And I think when you combine all of this with coming out of COVID, the impact on public services, I think people are partly worried, partly frustrated. And we see it in pockets of things. You know, we don't so much get the I can't see my GP that maybe we were seeing more of during COVID. But I think, I don't know how you describe it. It's not losing patients. I think it's just frustration of not being able to get the service, and that manifests itself into complaints. It's also one of those things. You know, my colleagues who've worked in complaints know this. When money gets tight, complaints tend to go up. And I think it's all of those things, not one of them. And I don't see it getting noticeably better in terms of demand on our service for the next short while. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, either of you.
I was just going to agree with that, Rosemary. I think that at times what you can see is that you'll get large volumes of complaints about a specific issue. And in those circumstances, what we would do is we would take one lead complaint. But that's not what we're seeing at the moment. It is just a general rise across the board in complaints. Obviously, if that happens, then we would manage it in that way. But that's not what we're seeing, and we're not able to batch cases in that way.
Okay.
Andrew. Well, coming through the networks, and my team are picking up that public bodies are definitely feeling more stretched, and they're seeing more complaints coming in. So we're trying to support them that way through engagement activities and sharing practice and giving a focus on resolution-based approaches to complaints. But the volume is still increasing, and you're getting that feeling from them that they are feeling stressed and stretched as well. And it's just a perfect storm at the minute.
Yeah, good point. You mentioned, Rosemary, that COVID disrupted the ability to get information from the public sector. And it says on your website that there's still a four-month delay. Was there anything else aside from the inability to get information that COVID created the delay?
For us, we were like every other public body. It affected our capacity because our own colleagues had homeschooling. Remember homeschooling? There was also COVID. You know, we caught COVID as well. So certainly for the first 3 months of the first lockdown, there was that adjustment to working in a different way. I would say in the reporting year here, what you've seen is we've had a much more stable environment. We've been much more geared up to working at home, but that still took time, or in a hybrid way, but that still took time from just the disruption on our own staff and our own ability to work.
Thank you very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you all. Nice to see you. Rosemary, I wanted to ask you a question about the number of complaints prior to you being in post. I think it was about 800 or so that went through the investigation stage prior to you taking up post, and then after you came in, that seemed to drop to 192. It was just to invite you to give some kind of reflection on why that is, what's happened there, why so few cases going beyond and being investigated, and so on and so forth, please.
I think it's probably worth at the outset saying what the word investigation means, because it has a very specific meaning within our Act. It's a formal step where you serve notice on the public body and you do a more formal investigation. But the everyday sense of the word, investigate, we don't investigate fewer. What we are doing, we have over a period of the last couple of years in particular, we are doing constant review of our own service. And what we are finding and what we have adjusted to doing is the result of model complaints handling and the engagement work means that we're seeing a much better investigation at local level than we've seen over the years. And for all sorts of reasons, I was reading the CRERA report yesterday. One of the things that it said was more complaints handling should be at local level. And actually, that's what we've achieved. And what we're seeing is the benefit of that. Now, that there are some complaints that won't go anywhere because they're out of jurisdiction. But once we've established whether we can investigate something, we then look to see whether we should investigate. And it's not that we don't do any work on them. Some of them we do quite a bit of work. But what we are doing at that stage is really exploring what's gone before us. So we'll often get the complaint file from the public body. We'll certainly follow up to see whether they've done what they said they do. But if we see evidence of a good investigation and we can achieve no more for the complainer than has already been achieved because there's learning taken place, there's a remedy put in place, it doesn't seem fair to put either a complainer or a public body through an investigation that's a more in-depth investigation that's pretty much going to repeat what's already been done and get to the same place. There is a fail-safe in that we also consider the public interest, because if there is something that needs to go through that, as you say, the 192, because there needs to be a public report, then that's what we will do. But what it enables us to do is be much more proportionate in how we use our resources for benefit across the board. The important things are that learning must be captured, the remedies that are promised must be put in place. And if we come across something where that doesn't happen, then we will progress it. The other thing, and I think this is something, if I were a complainer, I'd be saying, are you just doing what the public body says they've done? Are you just not looking at that? Well, actually, we do some, we call it inquiry, but it is a mini investigation, essentially, very often. Those type of decisions are made under my delegated authority. So I don't see those cases day to day, but there is a right of review. So if somebody is unhappy with that, either the complainer or the public body, they can ask for that case to be looked at by me. And it's not a huge number, but occasionally we will do a bit more investigation and we're open to reopening a case to look at it further. And I think that combined with our quality assurance and the other measures we have in place, what I think we have is a much more cost-effective and effective system, because if a public body has said they will do something and it addresses the issues found, if we then do an investigation, it could be quite a long time before somebody gets the remedy they're due. So in its entirety in the round, no, we don't do 800 in-depth investigations, but I think we get better outcomes now because we focus our resources where they're really most needed.
OK, could I just stick with that for a wee second, Rosemary? So let's say 800 complaints were valid in the past and now it's 192. Where is the difference going? Are they being pushed back to the public body, the local authority, for example, and to the public making the complaints to the ombudsman, who often think about you as the last port of call we have to go to the Ombudsman. And then are you writing to those complainers saying, we're not dealing with that, we think it's better dealt with locally by the public body or the council? But what message does that give to the public who want to use the Ombudsman as a kind of independent kind of arbiter about some of these issues?
I'm sorry, forgive me, I made an assumption. The process is that the model complaints handling requires the public body to look at something first. So if somebody comes to us with what we call a premature complaint, we signpost them back.
Okay.
And, you know, we can give help and support if they don't get responses. But it comes to us generally when it's been through that stage two. So the public body will have a complaint file. They will have done an investigation. And often the ones that we send back at that, you know, preliminary, just made an inquiry, where do I go stage, don't necessarily come back to us. So I think it's part of the actual complaints process that we are effectively the third stage. And people will know that. And there is a duty on public bodies under model complaints handling to signpost people to us. But the best remedies and the quickest remedies are often at local level, because instant action can be taken. I think it's local authority in particular, they resolve a lot of their complaints at that very early stage. So they basically just put things right. I can't remember the numbers. I don't know if you can.
Yeah, I was actually, if I can just add a little bit to that, I think two of the things that have helped reduce those numbers, one that Rosemary said, we've really had a focus with public bodies about signposting, so making sure that that is there, but going through their process first. So we, I think I said the last time we were here, we had relaunched our training offer for public bodies, so we now offer two different courses. So there's a good complaints handling and an investigation skills course. And through those courses, we've really focused on what makes good complaints handling. So there's been a real focus for all public bodies on putting their, you know, everyday complaints handlers through the good complaints handling. So we've had 425 sign-ups in the past year. But the investigation skills, we've had almost 500 officers from local authorities, bodies under jurisdiction, and we take them through that whole process. So for us, that's part of what we've taken from learning and improvement, and we've taken it back to the public bodies to saying, this is what makes a good complaint, to stop it escalating to here. But obviously signposting, if somebody's unhappy with it, this is what you should do. This is how you get to a good resolution. Here is how you agree it. So we take them through that step by step. And one of the things we're going to do now is start to really refine that in terms of sector-specific training. So at the minute, it's good complaints handling and it's investigation skills. But the feedback we're getting is that more specific examples would be helpful. So we're seeing that impacting on the complaints that are coming through as well. People are handling them better at that stage.
Are the public happy with that change in emphasis, if you like? Are we tracking what their view is of the overall satisfaction of their process, a complaints process?
We currently don't do, I should say, we have revised our approach to customer feedback, because traditionally we were only asking for feedback after we'd done that investigation. Now, clearly, we have a lot more closure points where we don't proceed any further. So next year we're relaunching that. We do get some, I think the two indicators are complaints about our service, but probably more so requests for review of those initial decisions. And in the entirety of the number of cases we do, it's very small. I think it's like everything else. There will be some people who are very unhappy, some who are very happy, and then those in between. But the key to this, I think, is actually explaining and explaining well. I do think there is a communication challenge in this, because we're not saying a complaint is unimportant. In fact, we're saying the exact opposite. The complaint is really important, but actually, if we can't do any more for you, and I think this ties in, not frequently, but sometimes with the expectation of what even an investigation could achieve. So, for example, we can't look at a complaint about education and say a teacher must be sacked. So there are occasions where I think it's the outcome was not what somebody wanted. But I wouldn't say it's lots and lots of people. It's often most vociferous, which is absolutely right, because if we don't aren't challenged, we don't review ourselves and look at ourselves and look at could we have communicated that better. But the other thing I just wanted to add on these cases that are resolved or addressed or don't go into this large investigation, we're increasingly looking at resolving, trying to find resolution where both parties, as long as learning happens, are happy to, with our intervention, to actually put something right. So a good example might be if there's an issue with a housing repair, rather than go through, investigate it, should they have done it, we might just phone up the housing association and say, we've got this complaint, you've already acknowledged that this should have been done, will you just put it right? And it's about changing, it sounds counterintuitive, but it's actually changed to being people-focused rather than process-focused, which I think can only be a good thing. But did you want to add anything, Nikki?
The only other thing that I wanted to state is, so in terms of premature complaints, if we receive premature complaints, we would tend to signpost back to the public body. But if it's quite clear that someone, the process is very frustrated, long running, somebody is having real difficulties and real challenges, we would certainly take into account any vulnerabilities the person was experiencing, and we would consider, and we do have the power to take that case, even if it's premature. So it's not something that we do often for the reasons that Andrew's explained, but we do have the authority to do that. The second point that I wanted to make was in terms of cases that, as Rosemary says, we use that term investigation advisedly, but for those cases that are not fully published investigations, on cases where we receive advice, 63% of the cases where we seek advice on are at that initial advice stage. So as Rosemary says, I think that just illustrates that it is not that there is no investigatory work going on in these cases. We are seeking professional advice. We're looking at these cases carefully. Some of our decisions communicating these findings are 16, 17, 18 pages long, arguably too long. They're incredibly detailed. So I think it's, as Rosemary says, that maybe the numbers and the terms don't actually describe the work that is, the extent of the work that is going on at that phase.
Okay. I certainly think the public view in terms of their satisfaction with the process is an important aspect to this, to keep some kind of track on going forward for us, Rosemary, if that's possible. So my other question might actually yield the same answer, but I'm going to ask it anyway. It was in relation to specific local authority complaints. The information we have here suggests that local authority complaints being closed after the investigation stage was only 25 out of a possible 1,151 last year. So the question arises again, why are so few local authority complaints investigated? That's quite a substantial difference, isn't it? So I'd invite you to explain that one if you can, please.
It's the assessment of whether to proceed is a whole range of things. But my take on this is actually the local authorities were the first to have model complaints handling procedures, and they're also the network that we've had the most contact with over the time. So I think some of it we are seeing good complaint handling at the first instance. There's also something about because of the breadth of different types of service they cover, that we see a lot of complaints where, as Nikki described about professional advice, if it was planning, for example, we're limited in what we can investigate, and our initial advice might be actually everything that's happened to this point is exactly what they've said should have happened. We won't proceed further on those. I couldn't tell you chapter and verse why, but I think it's a combination of the types of cases being so diverse and the length of time and the very active network group that is there, because Andrew, his team go to that, and they're very good at sharing good practice. They're quite proactive in comparing, monitoring stats and stuff like that. So I think it's something to do with the sector themselves, as well as the complaint handling. But I don't know if you want to add anything from the network groups or if that's enough.
Yeah, I would just add that they are a very active network, and they, when they meet, they split into family groups and they share trend analysis of the data that they capture on complaint handling. So they are actively now sharing good practice with each other, that we've kind of established that conversation. So we go along and we support that, and we share more relevant or up-to-date examples of support and learning that have been put in place. But they are now, as a network, doing that themselves in small family groups, and we're there to support that. They're also the network that probably engage most on any tweaks or changes that we make to guidance documents or information that's shared. So they're quite embedded in terms of the language. They understand the process really well. So they are, out of all the networks, the one who probably are further down that route, as Rosemary said, in terms of good complaints handling and good outcomes. And they're really focused more on people-centred now.
Having said that, take nothing on face value. So we are monitoring, and we constantly monitor. So the four areas that we get the most complaints about, housing, education, social care and planning, the ones that are most likely to go to more of an investigation would tend to be those education and social care, more complex complaints. But I say we take nothing on face value, so we do monitor. So by the end of quarter two in this year, we were up 29% on local authority cases. And significantly for me, what we have seen is that the premature rate, that is people coming to us before they have been through the process, is 28%. Which is slightly up, but before model complaints handling, it was 50%. So I think for the reporting year in place, okay, but we're not complacent and we will monitor it, but we can only monitor what people bring to us. So I think the other side of that is, if you're not happy with it, please progress it to us.
Just if you don't mind, just let me just pick that finally. Those numbers that I gave you there, 25 out of 1,151 were closed. Can you just give us an assurance, give the committee and the public an assurance that the difference, the 1,126, are being dealt with by someone? They're not being dismissed. They're being dealt with in a different part of the complaints process.
Yeah, I don't have the numbers to break this down specifically to local authority, but we could do if it would help afterwards. But just to give you an indication of those that we don't do that formal investigation on. Sorry, I'm just trying to find the numbers. I turned over the page. Yeah, it's that one. So in the reporting year, there were actually 1,915 cases that were closed after these initial stages. So of those, 1,288 were good complaint handling. So you can see a significant number had already been through a good complaint process. And some of the 376 of them were where the investigation looked reasonable, and although it hadn't been upheld, when we looked at it, we couldn't see anything more that could be achieved for the person. Now, what that means then is, if you look at some of the other things, so we resolved 44 of them, and our resolution rate is rising. What it means is, the number that actually we didn't look at in great detail is very, very low. It's probably under 150. Now, of those 110, we accepted them, but we sent them back, or said they're a valid complaint, but we formally returned them to the organisation to tell them to investigate. And obviously, we talk to complainers when we're doing this. So the vast majority have some form of investigation. It just doesn't come under that formal "we investigated". If I could change my legislation, the language is some of the things I would change in it.
Okay. Thank you very much for those responses. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. In the last 7 years, complaints have doubled regarding the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman's own services, and the SPSO largely puts this down to the backlog that is in the process of being cleared. So my question is around what steps does the Ombudsman plan to take moving forward to lower the volume of complaints they're getting? So my question to you, Rosemary.
It's a good question, because I'm not sure I'd necessarily always try and lower the volume of complaints, because it's a really valuable source of feedback. We would like fewer complaints which would demonstrate that our service is there. We have, over the last... it's the last few years now, since I've been in post, we have adopted the equivalent of the model complaints handling procedure. So we have a two-stage process ourselves, which is identical to the model complaints handling. Obviously, we can't have a third stage, which is the Ombudsman. So we contract an independent person to do that third stage investigation for us. So that is the process itself. So whatever that person's findings are, we will treat them as if an ombudsman had made them. We'd look for improvement and obviously feedback. The delay has been a big issue with certainly in the reporting year. But again, we have reduced the number of complaints about that, partly by reducing the delay, but also about managing it better and communicating better. Now, over and above that, I think what we're seeing is a reflection of what all of public service is seeing. I think there are other factors. It's not just about us. And very often what we see is that when a decision has been made that was a delegated decision and there's a right of review, what we will often see is somebody will engage with the review process, and if their complaint is not upheld still, they'll switch to a customer service complaint process. And I completely and utterly understand that. You'll try everything you can to get to the answer that you want to hear. And I think it's part, for me, of listening to what people have to say. So we'd like fewer of them, because it's obviously drain on... it's not a drain, but it's more resource for us. But I think the two important things are we monitor the trends and we monitor if there are specific subject areas. And delay was the only one that was the theme that went through. So we've tried to learn to tackle the delay, and it's not just in unallocated cases, it's in other areas of casework too, because the knock-on effect, one of the reasons we had unallocated cases is because of the knock-on effect of the investigations taking us longer, so having more old cases, so we couldn't allocate the new ones. So we did both together. So we're seeing a reduction in that. In terms of any other reductions, there is a combination of things that it's not just what's complained about, but it's the type of complaint. And it's very often the same person making the same complaint about everybody they come in contact with. And I just really want to help them understand that we're giving them, you know, a good service, but we can't always tailor it 100% to every single person. We try and engage in terms of making reasonable adjustments as far as we can, and we do actively ask at the beginning of when we get a complaint, is there anything you need us to do or communicate differently? And ultimately, sometimes it just comes down to, we can't please all of the people all of the time in every single way. But we do we do try very hard.
Can I just ask on that, Rosemary? You just mentioned that sometimes it's the same complainer. It could be in the four areas you've challenges you spoke about. How often does that happen? That rather than getting, I wouldn't say the word new complainers, but different complainers. Is it often the fact that you do get those repeat complainers quite a lot?
In numbers terms, it's not a huge number of complainers. So we could probably, you know, recall who they are over a two-year period. It's more the volume and similarity of what they complain about. So it's often the same complaint or a very similar complaint. And it's something that I find personally quite challenging because I want to help people move on. There comes a point where we can do no more, the public body can do no more. And those complaints, we're actually not quite a non-sector. We talk about reducing times and constant review of our processes, we do a lot more agile testing of new ways of working. And one of the things we're currently testing and working on is actually instead of taking all 10 of those complaints over a period of a few months, is make sure that we've addressed the basic and central issue, but not take every single complaint. And it's not that we don't want to, it's it doesn't help the complainer fundamentally. It doesn't help us, and it doesn't help the public body sometimes, because it can keep the same issue going round and round, sometimes for 5-6 years, without anybody getting any further on. So there's no single answer. We try and do everything we can, but stick to our value of people-focused.
No, thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Pam. I'm going to bring in Miles.
Thank you, Kamina. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us. I wanted to return to the question Willie Coffey had asked with regards to trends which you outlined, and just wondered if there is any analysis available at a national level now to look at those trends since SPSO took over the role of standardising complaint procedures, I think it was around 2010.
Right, it's to analyse trends, you have to have data. So we have engagement, we through the networks, and that enables us to analyse trends in particular sectors. We obviously do the same as many sensible organisations do. We do horizon scanning and we look for wider societal trends as well, because there's often a correlation between those and our own complaint numbers. We have in the last 2 years shifted our approach to how we use our own information. So in Andrew's team, we have what we call an insights officer, who's able to pull together all the bits of information we have. So not just numbers, but what recommendations have we made? Are there themes within recommendations? So communication is an eternal theme amongst all public bodies, I would say. But the other things then that enables us to do is identify from our data whether we get more from proportionally from one public body or one sector than another. And we couple that with our support and intervention policy, the focus being on support. Is there something we can do, offer that organisation or that sector to address some of the trends? So during the sort of reporting period, we did identify a trend with health complaints and delay and sometimes not even being looked at. So we proactively, a couple of times actually, wrote out to NHS boards and highlighted and offered support about perhaps how to address it during the COVID, the lockdown, times of high demand. We also, within that policy, if there is an organisation that we think needs to improve and they're not doing anything. We have different powers under complaint standards. Now, what we can't yet do, which it's partly a resource issue and it's partly how organisations themselves are set up. We do it for the whistleblowing function because there are fewer public bodies. There's a requirement to actually publish annual statistics. And in the whistleblowing standards, what we incorporated there was an annual reporting requirement. And we see all of the annual reports for whistleblowing. What we don't see in the same way, because we're simply not resourced for every single public body to say, send us your annual report so we can analyse them. Now, there is undoubtedly a technical solution to all of this somewhere down the line. I think as Information Commissioner we managed something, but it ultimately comes down to the benefit of doing it. And I think right now we get enough data to be able to do the intervention, the training, development and all that from our own data.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. That relationship which you've developed, being closer to bodies who, you know, people are complaining about, to try to speed up that, I think has attracted some comment. For example, in 2014, Professor Chris Skill, now at Glasgow University, but formerly at SPSO, wrote about these new responsibilities and engagement with public service bodies, but also the need for demonstrating sufficient independence during that period. So just wondered what safeguards you're making sure are embedded in that process.
Yeah, I would use the word closer advisedly, because that implies there is a different sort of relationship. So fundamentally, if you look at our investigatory work and our welfare fund work, they are independent decisions that we take independently. Our findings are our findings. They're not negotiable unless there's some form of material error. But that is very clear. We don't talk to public bodies about specific cases unless we're actually investigating something, obviously. Now, Andrew's team, what they have are the officers who give advice and guidance about complaint handling generally. So it's almost like two tram lines. One is about much as we want to get on professionally, I'm the ombudsman, you're a public body, I and my staff act independently and objectively. On the other tram line, what we want to do is improve the process for everybody, so we will give general advice, guidance, training. Now, I think, and it actually comes back to something, Mr. Coffey, that you touched on, I think our challenge at the moment is how we communicate those cases that don't go all the way through to this big investigation, because we have to be able to convince and demonstrate that they are taken independently. We're not just going on what the public body said because they said it. And I still think we have a challenge with that. But it's not Chinese walls. It's about being professional and recognising the limits. We will always make decisions independently. I think if you take any of my investigation staff and cut them in half, they'll say independent in the middle. And it's you know, something that we are all really conscious of. And I'm well aware with Professor Gill. I think his advice was very, very timely, because it would have been very easy, I think, with the complaint standard stuff to get too close. But even the network groups that we've mentioned, we don't run those. We're invited to go and speak at them, so aren't necessarily always there for everything they're talking about. And then at a different level, at a senior level, so like myself and Nikki, we have had to go and speak to public bodies about complaints handling or trends we've noticed. And that's a bit of a combination of the two. This isn't good enough, but we'd like to be able to help you to help yourself. So I don't know if that helps at all.
No, that's helpful. I didn't want to pick over Professor Gill's all his comments, but I thought there were some interesting pointers, like you've said, and around new responsibilities, actually, since 2014, which SPSO have been given. And he did express specific concerns with regards to, and I quote, "We should be asking whether such additional roles will help or hinder the Ombudsman institution in fulfilling its constitutional role." And I just wondered, in terms of those comments, if you'd considered that, given new responsibilities as well.
Obviously, since 2014, and I became Ombudsman in 2017 and took on the whistleblowing stuff since then, and we're also likely to be developing child-friendly complaints, I would say we learn ourselves so much from the stakeholder engagement and the actual doing of the work. I think it's very good advice about consider that relationship, because it does alter slightly each time. But I would say it's definitely a help, not a hindrance. The hindrance would be is if you didn't do it well and didn't do it professionally. But I think if you come at it from the approach that we take in relation to our values and our strategic aims about learning and improvement, it's also about building capacity, not just our capacity, the capacity of the complaint system, which actually takes us all the way back to CRERA, actually, about should be better complaint handling locally. They all fit together in a different way. So help, not hindrance.
That's helpful. Thank you. Thanks, Kavina.
Thanks, Miles. I've just got a couple of questions around the public petition relating to the SPSO. It's being considered by the Parliament Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. And among other things, the petition calls for an independent review to establish whether the current legislation governing the SPSO is fit for purpose. And given that you are also pushing for legislative change, I'd be interested to hear if you agree that 20 years after the legislation setting up the SPSO, a review may be required. And if so, who do you think should conduct that review?
How long have we got? okay. I absolutely fundamentally think there should be a review. I've been trying since I came into office to get that review. There are a number of reasons for this. From a complainer point of view, our Act was written at a time when everybody did everything in writing and kept paper files. And I don't think that it's adaptable enough as adaptable as it should be for different ways of delivering services and making complaints. Each time we've had a new function, it's added something in, and it's an incredibly messy piece of legislation to read now. And I think there is something about making it clearer. It's not just lawyers who read legislation. Within that, though, there are some areas where, as an Ombudsman service and organisation, we are not keeping up with our colleagues, certainly in other areas of the UK and across Europe. And this relates to own initiative investigations, which I won't go back to because we've talked about before. But then there are other, I think, more, maybe not as obvious, but other things that would help. And that is this, it's almost this relationship thing again about being able to share information differently with other scrutiny and oversight bodies, because as public services become more complex, the scrutiny and oversight of public services is quite complex, and I think there needs to be a review of how those bodies are enabled to work together, because it's often the legislative things which get in the way. And as to who does it, I would leave that to the greaters and betters, but I can't see that a parliamentary scrutiny of our legislation would go amiss.
It would certainly kick things up in the air or get things started, wouldn't it? So you mentioned that you weren't going to go over the own initiative investigative powers, and I know we did discuss that, I think, last year when you were here, or earlier this year. But I would be just so we get it all on the record here. It'd be interesting to hear from you what you think these ombudsmen in, for example, Wales and Northern Ireland and other international schemes are able to do that you're not able to do. And if you have a sense that the lack of own initiative powers hinder your ability to fulfil your responsibilities.
So I can only investigate at whatever stage a complaint if it is brought to me. If somebody doesn't complain, I can't investigate. Under own initiative powers, you're able to investigate something in the public interest of your own volition. Now, arguably, you can say, well, can't you research it now? Yes, you can. But when you have the own initiative powers, you have the other things within the Act that come with it, like being able to compel evidence and information. And what it enables you to do is focus on an issue or a demographic or a theme without having to focus on a particular public body. It also means that you can phrase it and word it to get to the issue you're trying to look at. Because I think with complaints, sometimes you have to go with what the complainer is complaining about. Now, the benefit of that is you can do one investigation that is cross-cutting in one way or another that doesn't necessarily, right, you've got to do this, do that, but it really highlights an issue and it really enables the underlying themes that might prevent or help other complaints and complainers. Now, the other benefits to this is it's a far more effective use of resources. You might achieve with one investigation what you couldn't achieve with 10, 20 complaints. But for me, I think fundamentally, the way that you choose and decide what to investigate, it ties in with what Nikki mentioned about people in vulnerable situations. I'm as interested in knowing why some people don't complain and whether the complaint system as a whole serves everybody as it should. So you can look at those very different issues, and it is actually the way that, if you sort of go back to sort of textbook things, voice for the voiceless, I think that would give far more of a voice for the voiceless than us being able to only look at the complaints that come to us.
Yeah, I think that's certainly a good point, that not everybody complains, but there's people who are sitting on something that they would really could do with some help and support. Okay, so thanks for unpacking that a bit. That's very helpful. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, who's joining us online.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Rosemary, you touched in your opening remarks about what you're doing to develop the child-friendly complaints, and obviously you might want to expand on that a bit. But also, we heard from you last year, obviously you're talking about there's vulnerable groups who are not making complaints. You just kind of referenced that a wee second ago there. And obviously, kind of, don't obviously know, you know, what the barriers are in terms of the making complaints, but I just wanted to ask what you're doing to reach out to those groups and individuals.
Okay, so it won't be in the last reporting one. It's work that we're doing this year. We're refocusing our engagement strategy, our stakeholder engagement, to try and identify how we can get better contact. We have a number of individual initiatives, and I might ask Andrew to talk about one that's related to data. We have also been working with jointly with the Northern Ireland Ombudsman and a couple of academics, one of whom you know. They're looking specifically at how you identify vulnerable people in vulnerable situations, and we've had a couple of workshops with them, and they're going to be developing some resources that we will have on our website, host on our website for advice for public bodies, because whilst we would like to have greater contact, actually it's how at front line there is more support in terms of complaints. So it's a work in progress, but I'm just going to ask Andrew to talk about the data bit of it, if you don't mind.
Yep. So the Insight Officer and my team started to look at all the stats from last year. So we pulled all the complaints that came in and we broke them down across all the local authorities. And then we used the deprivation index to target where the complaints were coming from people in deciles 1 to 4, just looking at the most vulnerable deciles to begin with. And then we further drilled into that to look at what sector the complaints within those deciles were more likely to come from. So we now are at a stage where we have a vast amount of data that will help us direct our engagement over the next year. So, for example, we can look at a local authority. We can see that people that are experiencing the most vulnerabilities within those deciles are more likely to complain about housing issues. So then that allows my team to engage with those public bodies and support them. So what are the issues? How can we help you to have better complaints handling? But the key thing that Rosemary touched on is it's the hidden data, and that's the bit that we're trying to pull out now. So we can see across the 32 local authorities, well, why does that local authority not have anybody in decile 1 and 2 complaining about this service? It might be that that local authority is doing a fantastic job and there's nothing to complain about, but actually, or public body, sorry, but it might be that actually the process isn't right for them. So part of this project, which we're, you know, we could go 100 miles an hour and go every avenue down this, but we're trying to pull it back, is we're now looking at, well, how are our materials supporting public bodies and supporting members of the public to access our service? Is it the language isn't right? Do we need to look at easy read? Do we need to look at how we are communicating to bodies under our jurisdiction and that they should be relaying that back to members of the public? So there's a whole myriad of projects that can come out of this draft of data that we've pulled. And we've only been doing that this year. But the keys for next year moving forward will be the engagement that comes out of that will be driven from that data. So my team will actively look at where can we have the biggest impact? Where are we going to get the most in terms of improving complaints handling from this data?
The other thing is, I talked about, we do a lot of, you know, very quick, small projects. So a specific example will be, it's quite challenging communicating and making complaints for prisoners. And we completely reviewed the literature for prisoners and actually followed the advice, because there are quite high rates or low rates of literacy. I'll assume Marie's there, even though it's only her name showing, in prison. So we reframed it using guidance from the Dyslexia Association on how to communicate. So there isn't a big bang for everything. We're just trying to do it within our resource as much as we can individually.
I was just going to add, in terms of the welfare fund applications, we take all of our applications over the phone, whereas that isn't the case at first tier review stage. For local authorities, some have free phone numbers, for example, but not all local authorities do. So I think it's, as Rosemary says, it obviously is about accessing, easy access to our service, and we've worked really hard with our teams to make sure that across all three areas of casework that happens through regular training, feedback, etc. But it is also about how people access service, the public services themselves, and I think there's more work to do, in particular, I would say, around the welfare fund.
Thank you. Rosemary, one of my constituents raised an issue about a complaint not being accepted because it was made in the name of a local community council. I just wanted to ask, what avenue does a community council have to make a complaint if it's about a kind of local authority?
I would find it difficult to answer the question without it being obvious what I was talking about. Would it be possible for me to write to you afterwards about community councils, because it's quite a complex area, and I would rather make sure that I give you the right answer than try to edge around it, if that's okay.
I would certainly welcome that, Rosemary. That would be really helpful. Thanks. I'll move on to my last question. Obviously, kind of earlier on in the year, you're saying that you'd started to kind of log complaints about housing repairs, specifically about dampness and mould, and it's something the committee's very interested in. And obviously, you were saying that the numbers were very low, but can you advise the committee of, you know, what you're doing to obviously to find out what complaints are there? And has it been a kind of a big jump in numbers?
Well, the first thing we did was we started actually putting a log on them in our case handling system. So when we spoke to you in May, we had 10 cases logged. That figure's now 39. So we've already looked at... So obviously they're going up. We have 39. Statistically, what is interesting is 17 of those were premature cases, which meant the issue had not been even addressed or looked at local level. And I think that is probably a combination of not knowing where to complain or not knowing how to push that. So we have... got cases in the pipeline, obviously. Some of them are still under investigation. There have been a few where, actually, when the complaint about the damper mould was made, six of those, they were properly investigated at the local level and addressed. What we are finding, though, is that, and it's a generalisation, and it's only a small number, but organisations are responding to concerns, and we've not had to do a really big in-depth investigation yet. I will always say yet. I think some of this will be driven by the publicity about it, but because of the way this particular issue has emerged publicly, I think it's going to be less likely that we see a public body not looking into it because of the implications. But at this moment, we're tracking it. It's watch this space. And yes, they've almost quadrupled in numbers.
Thanks for that, Rosemary. Back to yourself, convener.
Thanks very much, Marie. And that's comes to the end of our questions. But you said at the beginning you wanted to cover certain areas. We do have a little bit of time. So if there's anything that you want to highlight or make sure we really hear, that you're welcome to do that. I mean, certainly what I've been hearing from you is that you're taking in general, a very proactive approach, kind of preemptive work, and all of this kind of like being effective and really kind of looking for that people-centred approach that you're going for. And you know, I love the idea that rather than being stuck with the process, following that to the end, it's actually looking for the solution for people and meeting that need. So I think that's tremendous that that's beginning to work out.
Yeah, I think the couple of things that I did want to highlight are the work on the independent national whistleblowing officer. And I'm sort of running out of voice, so if you feel like you'd like to do that, and also touch on the current state with unallocated cases.
Okay,
cause
great.
There's good news there.
Yeah, I'm happy to do a brief update on the IMWO, because obviously it's the second year of IMWO now for SPSO. A lot of work went into the preparation, working with boards to get ready. We talked about the annual reporting process earlier. So unlike with public service complaints, we have been able to analyse the first set of annual reports on IMWO. And really that's been able to then direct the activity that we've undertaken with boards, producing guidance for them about where they need to consider. I think one of the challenges for boards at the moment is very much about how they report the learning from these cases whilst very clearly protecting the confidentiality of the parties involved. So I think that is still something that that we're learning from. We had a very successful second Speak Up Week in October of this year, where the focus was very much on how you ensure that you are driving learning and improvement from these cases, not just in the specific instance, but sharing that more widely across organisations. So I think that these investigations are proving to be very complex in nature, some of them, and we're using a wider range of investigative techniques than we would normally use on public service complaints. But we're working, it's a relatively small team, our INWO team. It's around five people within that team. So there is learning on our part as well. But I think as we're going through, we're working well with public bodies. We're carrying out reflective reviews on the cases that we're undertaking. And you'll see from our website, we're publishing findings. So it was really just to highlight in this second year, there is still work to do, but we are very much finding our feet in terms of investigative processes that we're using.
Thanks for that. That sounds like a very positive direction. And I do think I remember seeing promotion for the Speak Up Week in October. So it cut through even somebody who's very busy.
Just the final one, because I know the committee have had an interest in our unallocated cases. As of yesterday, we had 288 cases waiting allocation. Obviously, these aren't the same 288 there were right back at the beginning of the year, but that is in the context of a 40% increase in the numbers coming in. So the systems that we've put in place are really working effectively. It's marginally just under 4 months still for some cases, and I have to stress the sum, because we do prioritise cases that will get allocated in sort of half that time. It's not ideal, but we're still seeing the direction of travel, and actually it's been a really helpful learning experience for us in how we manage that and keep the throughput of work going, and we still at the same time are working on making sure we don't have lots of older complaints by the end of the year. So the direction of travel is still in the right direction. I had hoped it would be a little quicker, but I wasn't anticipating quite such a big rise as 40%.
That's great. Thanks for that update. And I just want to check, do you still want to come in? Yeah, come on in.
Thanks, Convener. Rosemary, just to follow up briefly on the Marie McNair's question there on the dampness and mould issue. Are you aware at all of authorities still regarding complaints from tenants about dampness and mould being categorised as condensation and therefore not dampness and mould? We've had this problem for many years, and some of us who have served in local authorities have experienced this. And it appears to be the case that dampness and mould wasn't a recognised danger to prevent a local council from allocating a personal house that's in that condition. So I wouldn't like to think that that's still the case, that people's complaints about dampness and mould are being disregarded and regarded as condensation only. Could you say anything about that at all, and whether we are actually gathering these complaints in fully and properly now?
I don't have the data to say absolutely it does or it doesn't. And it's unfortunate in a way. Dampness, mould and condensation are three different things. They may cause each other, but they're not necessarily the underlying issue. I think what I would come at it from a slightly different perspective is we are seeing better handling of complaints about those issues generally, and the fact that none of them have got to us in this current year, because obviously we're tracking it this year, that have raised that as a major issue. It doesn't mean they won't reach us, but it's not a theme that's come through in the way that I have recognised it in the past.
I'm sorry, I was looking at our policy officer who will know the cases in more detail than me. It's not something that's been raised through a case, but what we will do is alert our teams to make sure that we're looking out for that, to be able to capture that as an issue.
Okay, Thanks for that. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. Well, that concludes our questions. And I think it's been very helpful to hear from you again. And I'm glad that we were able to move it to this side of the year rather than 6 months on, as you say, when it's fresh in your minds. So thank you very much for your evidence today. And I'll now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses. Thank you. Now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the annual report of the Scottish Housing Regulator 2022-23 from George Walker, who is the chair, and Michael Cameron, who is the chief executive at the Scottish Housing Regulator. And I'd also like to welcome Paul Sweeney, MSP, to the meeting, who has joined us for this item. And I'd like to begin by inviting George to make an opening statement.
Convener, thank you very much. I might take just a minute or so more on my opening statement this time than I've done before, just because so much has gone on since the time of publishing our annual report, so I hope that's acceptable to the committee. I promise I won't drone on for too long. But thank you so much, Convener and Committee, for inviting us to present the annual report today for 22-23. We published in October, as you'll know. But since March, the end period of the report, so much has happened. And we really did want to draw your attention to some of these important developments since then. So I'll start with homelessness, if I may. I'll share some analysis with you on new build and what's happening there. And I'll also update you on RAC, which is pretty hot off the press, if I might. So to start with homelessness, we've previously spoken about this. And back in February, we said in our thematic review of homelessness services that for some councils, there was an emerging risk of systemic failure. That was a significant statement. Since then, the Scottish Government published statistics showing an increase in the number of homelessness applications. Today, as we sit here, the number of people and children in temporary accommodation is now the highest on record. And they are spending longer in temporary accommodation than in the past. Our ongoing engagement with councils about the delivery of services for people who are homeless have found that breaches of statutory duties are now a regular occurrence in some councils. In the recently submitted annual assurance statements to us as the regulator, 14 local authorities stated they do not always fully comply with their duties, and some acknowledge that they are not able to meet their duties to people who are homeless, are not always able to meet their duties to people who are homeless. Our analysis of the recently submitted social landlords' annual returns on the charter have identified that fewer existing homes are becoming available. And when they do, they are empty for longer. So the net effect is that fewer homes are available to let. In addition to those already in temporary accommodation, some councils are concerned that there is going to be an additional demand for homelessness services resulting from the Home Office's initiative on streamlining the asylum process. We see that the demand in some areas now certainly exceeds the capacity to respond. We are now of the view that there is a systemic failure in the services provided by some councils and that there is a heightened risk for other councils too. While we'll of course continue to monitor, assess and report on homelessness, we recognise that systemic failure requires an intervention beyond the regulatory powers given to us by Parliament. Yesterday we published a statement updating our thematic review to reflect this current position about systemic failure in some homelessness services provided by some councils. We of course stand ready to work with the Scottish Government and stakeholders to address these acute issues that we see in homelessness. Now, we're very aware of your own Parliament's recent debate on housing. Our view is that the context for tenants and social landlords has never been more challenging. But social landlords have worked hard and kept rent increases in the last couple of years to levels below the prevailing rate of inflation. That's undoubtedly been of immediate help to those tenants struggling to manage household finances. However, rent arrears are at the highest level since the introduction of the Charter, and landlords are facing real pressures in funding future investment in their tenants' homes and in services. Related to this, I do want to highlight a recently published analysis of RSL five-year financial projections. So this takes us up to the 27-28 year. And what we see in that is a reduction in the new homes that RSLs will build and in the number of RSLs who plan to build. That's also in decline. This is due to cost increases in construction and impacts of the cost of borrowing for RSLs. They're also planning to cut back or delay investment in existing homes too, so troubling. These same organisations are also halving the expenditure on non-core activities. What's that? Well, that's things such as welfare and energy advice that they provide. Not part of core, as I said, and having expenditure on that significant. The impact on current tenants and people experiencing homelessness could be really very significant. So this is further evidence of the significant pressures that tenants and landlords are having to cope with. Let me turn to RAC. As you know, indeed, Convener, we discussed it when we last met. We've been working with stakeholders to establish the extent of RAC in social housing in Scotland. From our ongoing data collection, which we started in October, we know that 9 social landlords have a total of 953 homes with RAC. We'll continue to update these figures as landlords conclude their ongoing investigations of possible RAC. And, of course, we are engaging with those landlords that have confirmed RAC in homes to get assurance about the plans to deal with managing this. Finally, I want to report that we're progressing well with the review of our regulatory framework. We started that in June with a discussion paper, and we've used the feedback from that to develop specific proposals, which we are now consulting on. This consultation closes on 15th December. We'll cogitate and consider the feedback from that and produce a final framework in February for implementation in April. Alongside that, we're also revising our corporate strategy that, again, will start from April. I'm happy to say that feedback's been broadly very supportive. There's a clear sense that the sector wants stability and that the existing framework has been working well. We agree with that. The existing framework has been working well. At present, while we're engaging with a number of landlords, I'm very pleased to report that we have no statutory interventions currently underway. The main proposals that we've made are around allowing for us to ask for further detailed information on emerging topics, topics such as damp and mould in the annual landlord assurance statements. We're also looking in the framework to clarifications on the regulatory status based on feedback from tenants and importantly lenders to the sector. We'll also be doing a comprehensive review of the annual charter return. Part of that is safety related, and we want to collaborate with the sector to develop key measures around safety issues such as damp and mould, and that's complex, so you can see our collaborative approach matters. We will wrap this up with work on the indicators we will use to monitor landlords' achievement of the newly proposed social housing net zero standard, and we'll do a further consultation on that combined towards the end of the year. Of course, throughout all this, we'll be very happy to keep the committee updated in our work via the clerks or by coming to visit should that be needed. Convener, I'm sure you'll have questions for us, so I'll hand back to you, and we're happy to answer any questions or discuss anything you'd like.
Thanks very much, George, and thanks for that very thorough introduction and kind of getting into some of the detail about homelessness, but also highlighting your awareness around maybe more data to be gathered around damp and mould, which has become an issue that the committee's taken on. I'd like to open, and you did touch on this a little bit in your opening statement, around the challenging operating environment for social landlords and the financial pressures on tenants. But I'd be interested to hear how it's impacted on your regulatory approach and what it means for tenants and other service users and landlords.
Okay, happy to take that. Shall I start on that, Michael, and I'll see if you'd like to add something. That's a very sensible question. There's no doubt in our minds that this is probably the most challenging, volatile, uncertain, I suppose, environment that social landlords, tenants and service users have experienced. I think that's clear. The economic uncertainty and volatility over the last 3 years has been unprecedented, and frankly, to me at times, has felt pretty relentless. And that's what we hear from tenants and landlords. I could give you the kind of rhyme and reason on inflation and Bank of England. I think you know that, so I'll probably not get overly bogged down in that detail, but we know the effect it's having. A couple of points, though, to make is I think we all know that food and drink inflation remains high, regardless of headline inflation rates having fallen. The annual rate hit just over 19% in March, and it fell a little bit to 17.3% in June. And the last monthly data shows that this has slowed to around 10%. So that's a good thing, but it just means that prices are rising slower and still at 10%. Why do I comment on that? Because poorer households, it's just the reality, spend much more of their budget on essentials such as foods. And we know that they are the most exposed to high food inflation. So we mustn't be drawn into thinking that because headline inflation has fallen, that has taken the pressure off some of these poorer households. It really hasn't in many cases. We're very aware too for landlords, to your point about the whole sector, convener, we're very aware for landlords that cost inflation, especially in maintenance and in new construction, is running at 10 to 20%, so significant. And in our regular meetings with landlords that operate in rural and island areas, it's even more dramatic. We recently heard of cost increases in maintenance costs of 30 to 40% over the last 2 years. And so there's just one area where social landlords, the inflation they're experiencing is running way ahead of CPI. I'll touch on the fact that what's happened with Bank of England rates of the rapid increase to 5.25% has really had now beginning to hit home. About 25% of the borrowing from social landlords is on variable rates. And so that has fed through to increased interest charges of about £66 million a year. So quite a significant chunk of revenue that's going to hit. There's no doubt in our minds at all that social landlords have made considerable efforts to minimise the impact of these challenges on their tenants. We really see evidence of that. They've certainly tried to limit rent increases to levels below what they would have had in their original business plans, which are usually linked to inflation. But that does mean that landlords have less income than originally planned in the current and future years, so less resources to invest in tenants' homes and services, as we've said. Another example would relate to their wider activities. I touched in an opening statement about the cutback in these wider non-core activities such as welfare advice, energy advice, social landlords support tenants in a host of ways. And again, as I referred to, we're seeing plans to cut the investment they put into that in half, which is quite significant. So we really recognise that in that current context means that social landlords are having to make tough decisions to prioritise where they pay attention and focus their resources so that's on the most critical issues for them. Just to reassure the committee, we absolutely are taking these challenges into account in our risk assessment this year, which we went public on fairly recently, and we'll continue to respond to that changing landscape and the challenges that landlords and tenants face. So I suppose what I'm saying to the committee, please rest assured, we will focus on the big current challenges that face tenants and landlords in the cost of living crisis. We won't do regulation by tick box. We will focus on what's in front of us at the time. And that will be on issues around the cost of living crisis, affordability, of course, and the acute issues around the number of people in temporary accommodation, the emerging requirements on landlords on net zero, damp and mould, and resident safety. So to the final part of your question, that's the approach that we'll be taking as a regulator to this, is to focus on these live issues now as they emerge. I hope that helps.
That certainly is very helpful to hear that, that is your approach. And I'd just like to actually pick up on, you spoke extensively at the beginning about the thematic review of homelessness. And I just wanted to, and you actually kind of covered some of the question I was going to ask you, but I just wondered, you mentioned that there's a number of local authorities who are not able to comply or meet the needs. And I just wondered how you are monitoring how the councils are going to make progress and actually move towards compliance.
Perfect. You want to pick
that up? Yes, I'm happy to pick that up. So, yes, convener, as you said, in February we published our thematic report on homelessness services in Scotland and flagged at that time this very real risk of systemic failure. Yesterday we updated that statement, as George has advised you on, to highlight that we are now of the view that there is systemic failure in some councils in relation to some of the services which they deliver for people who are homeless. We are engaging with all of those councils which we have identified, and we will be updating the engagement plans for each of those councils to reflect that current assessment, so that will happen in the coming weeks. We will look to all of those councils to continue their best efforts to meet their statutory duties towards homeless people and to engage in the dialogue that is going on at the moment at a national level to look at alternative approaches to dealing with the most immediate challenges, particularly those acute problems for people who are in temporary accommodation or looking to access temporary accommodation. And as George says, we will continue to work with the Scottish Government and other stakeholders in the area of homelessness to look for opportunities and different ways that we can address these very real and acute issues.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Just in terms of the 14 councils, is it the same issue or is it nuanced across all of them, different issues? Is it really just a lack of housing stock or...?
We looked across six different aspects of performance and statistics for each of the councils. So looking at, for example, around breaches of the unsuitable accommodation order or failures to provide temporary accommodation when it's required, but also looking at issues such as the number of people in temporary accommodation, including number of children, and also the direction of travel in terms of demand for that type of accommodation. So there were a number of dimensions that we looked across. Some of the councils that we are focusing on have, if you like, the red status in some of those dimensions. A smaller number have them across all of those dimensions. So it's variable across councils and across the country.
I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol, the supplementary.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. I've got kind of two supplementary questions. You've mentioned, obviously, 14 councils, but so far, obviously, there's three councils that have declared a housing emergency, and many are breaking statutory duties, every day, and you have, like I said, mentioned 14. Do you think it's time that the Scottish Government should be declaring a housing emergency?
Well, what we've set out very clearly is a statement that we consider that there is in relation to the provision of services to homeless people. There is systemic failure. I think language such as housing emergency is not something that sits in our regulatory framework. So I think that would be for others to consider whether that's an appropriate form of language. We'll look at the individual councils. And the position there. We will set out in the coming weeks our assessment in the published engagement plans for each of those councils, and we will then engage with those councils around what they are in a position to do. But importantly, we'll also engage with Scottish Government and other stakeholders to consider what wider options there may be to tackle those very acute issues that we're seeing, particularly in relation to the provision of temporary accommodation.
No, thank you for that response, but obviously councils are going through really challenging times, and I've had the opportunity to speak to many councils in the last couple of weeks, and they have been speaking about obviously budget cuts and pressures. So just on that, obviously there's currently more than 200,000 people on the social housing waiting list, including 100,000 children. So what should the Scottish Government do different to ensure that these lists are drastically reduced? So I know you mentioned, obviously, you're looking at councils, but the councils are looking at the Scottish Government for support and help as well. So is there anything you feel that they could do differently, the Scottish Government?
Well, as I say, our role is to regulate individual landlords, including local authorities. Having said that, obviously, we do engage with the Scottish Government around the wider systemic situation. And a systemic failure does require a systemic intervention. And that's well beyond the powers that the Parliament has provided to us. We don't have those systemic intervention powers. At the heart of this is the supply of homes to allocate to people who are experiencing homelessness. And the Scottish Government has a programme to deliver new social homes, and that is absolutely critical. However, the new build programmes, new developments take time to deliver, and we are seeing real challenges around the cost of new build. And as George has touched on, our analysis of the financial projections of RSLs has given us a clear sense that the RSLs are showing significant reductions in plans to build new homes and in the number of homes that they will be building. So I think it remains critical, that supply side. Know that the Scottish Government's also looking at a national acquisition plan to see whether there are alternative approaches to deliver that increase in supply that will be needed. But our sense is that that now needs to happen at pace to deal with the very immediate challenges that are in front of all of us. I think there's also a need to look at the direct provision of support to local authorities and to registered social landlords to enable them to maintain the services that people who are experiencing homelessness need now and will need to help them to sustain tenancies.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thanks, Pam. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thank you very much. Good morning to you both. Just to follow up on that point that Pam Gozal was making there, there's a paper coming up following this item with you guys that tells us that in Scotland there's 70,000 long-term empty houses. How does that square with your comments about systemic failure from some councils to deal with homelessness? How have we got such a huge number of long-term empty houses and such a high number of homelessness, homeless people in Scotland?
Well, many of those empty houses are obviously not in the social rented sector. So there's an imperative to understand where those homes are and how quickly and effectively they might be able to be brought back into use. Obviously, to let as a social home, it has to meet Scottish Housing Quality Standard, and that in itself can be a challenge for some of these homes that are empty. The National Acquisition Plan, which I mentioned and touched on there, is one vehicle through which perhaps that can be done. I know that there are a number of other initiatives that are in place to bring empty homes back into play. And it may very well be that in the current financial context where we're seeing the costs of construction being prohibitive in some regards, that maximising the use of the stock that is already there is increasingly important. In terms of empty homes within the social housing sector, we are engaging with some landlords around ensuring that they are maximising their approach to bring those homes back into use. And part of the conversation that I know is happening with the Scottish Government and other stakeholders is whether there are further initiatives that might be able to accelerate. We know that it is taking longer for homes that become empty to get back into use. A lot of that is to do with some of the challenges around cost and availability of contractors. We're seeing some challenges around utility companies and ensuring that appropriate supply is available in homes when they are ready for relet, and that's a growing concern, I know, among social landlords. So there are a number of areas where I think there's initiatives that can be undertaken, but I think it's not. I think sometimes the statement, you know, there are a lot of empty homes out there, maybe kind of understate some of the challenges there can be in bringing some of those homes back into use. Though, as I say, there are a number of initiatives in play that may very well help to ease the supply side through that, targeting homes that are available either for purchase or are empty and can be brought back into use.
Do you track the various figures that you know that are important here, Michael, like the number of social rented long-term empties being allocated to people who are temporary or long-term homeless? Are we tracking that?
We monitor landlords' performance around lettings and management of empty homes, and we produce statistics on an annual basis for that. One of the things which we are in conversation with the Scottish Government and other stakeholders about is whether whether it would be helpful for us to put in place a more regular data collection from landlords around some of these key things, letting of homes, management of empty homes, number of homeless people that are being allocated such homes on a short-term basis to help understand the effectiveness of any measures that are brought forward. And we have a meeting later this week where that very topic will be discussed further. So while we do it on an annual basis, it may very well be that we do it on a more frequent basis before too very long. And that would reflect the similar approach that we took during the pandemic, when we had monthly data collections from landlords on some of the key areas of performance to ensure that everyone understood the impact that the pandemic was having on landlords' ability to deliver those services. So a similar approach may very well be put in place within the next couple of months.
Right. That's really helpful, Michael. Thank you very much for that. George, in your remarks and in response to some of the questions, you made some really positive comments about attempts by landlords to control their expected rent rises. You mentioned that several times, and it's just to ask you to flesh this out a wee bit if you can, and conversely the impact of that initiative and that work that they're doing to invest in their stock. So you mentioned that a couple of times. If you get any more you could add to that in terms of numbers, how many are doing that? Is it widespread? Is it a small number? Do you give the committee a sense of how many landlords are embracing your recommendations?
Yeah. I do have some things I can give you on that. I probably don't have specific numbers to hand on that today, but I can certainly provide you with some more data on it. So what I'm about to say is maybe more high level, if I can put it that way, Mr. Coffey, in terms of that. But in terms of coming back from the pandemic, I suppose the place to start is actually the good news that we see from landlords is that in many cases, they're back to providing pretty much the full range of services that they were pre-pandemic. And that's a good thing. It might even be a surprising thing given the cost challenges that have been hit. Now, are those things perfect? No, there'll be gaps here and there. But it would be fair to say that they've stepped up to that challenge. And they've been hit, of course, not only by the pandemic, but, you know, the dual challenges of, you know, global impacts and inflation, etc., as well as we've touched on. In terms of probably things I would highlight is there is a struggle with, I will come on to the rent thing in a second, but there is a struggle with a lower turnover of homes than pre-pandemic. And this is something that we think is quite significant and something that hasn't come back to pre-pandemic levels and this plays through. And what I mean by that is around 1,700 fewer homes became empty during the last 12 months. That's quite a big number. And that's nearly 5,000 fewer than if we go back as far as 2019, 2020. So that's a significant slowing of turnover, if you like, of social housing. And landlords are certainly impacting. That's impacting landlords and tenants. Michael touched on, and to your questions around empty homes and so on, and Michael touched on the fact that the landlords were struggling to re-let rapidly enough. To give you some specifics on that, in 2019, it took about 32 days, actually, by my numbers, to relet an empty property. Today it's taking 56. And that's a gap. And Michael touched on some of the reasons with that around availability and cost of the services to deliver that. And the one thing I'll draw your attention to is, of course, that then means they lose rent from those empty homes, even in that relenting. By our estimate, it's about 38.7 to be exact, 38, 39 million of lost rents down due to that. So you can see where some of the challenges are. But in terms of what landlords are trying to do to alleviate this, it would be fair to say that we do believe that they're making significant efforts. The evidence says that over the last couple of years, as I said, rents have increased at below the rate of inflation. To give you some numbers on that, CPI inflation was averaging 8.7%. The average rent increase by social landlords was 5.1%. The median was 5%, so actually reasonably behind what CPI inflation was showing. Now, to be clear, averages and medians can mislead. There was a range in that, to be honest with you, and that range for RSLs ranged from 0 some had no rent increases, up to as high as 8%. But that 8% was still behind the 8.7 average that there was at the time. So that just gives you a sense of the scale of the rent increases that, that they've been tackling and what they've been trying to do against this backdrop. And the final thing I do want to draw your attention to, actually, because it is quite important. During the pandemic in particular, we did have some safety concerns. And those safety concerns were around gas safety and access to homes. You can imagine during a pandemic, access to homes is difficult, both for landlords and worrying for tenants themselves. And there was a gap in some landlords in getting those done. But actually, I'm quite pleased to see that post-pandemic, social landlords are now back to meeting. In the last year, they've done 99.8% of the gas safety inspections. That's a very significant recovery from where they were when they struggled with access during the pandemic. So I hope that gives you some flavour, and those rent increase numbers give you some flavour that go to your question. We'll have a look at what other data we've got and can give you on more specifics to that on numbers of landlords and so on, because we do have all of the data on the suite of what landlords have been doing with rents and can, I'm sure, provide you with that.
That's really, really helpful again, George. The only thing that occurs to me to ask you about is, has it had any impact on the landlord's ability to retrofit? You know, if their, you know, their median rent rise is lower than inflation, is it having any impact on their ability to get their properties retrofitted for net zero and so on?
Well, Michael may have something specifically on retrofit. To front of my mind, I don't, but I did touch on this idea of reinvesting in existing stock, and I touched on the five-year financial projections that we're looking at, and there's no doubt that we're seeing evidence emerge of landlords finding it challenging to reinvest in their existing stock. But that can be a whole host of things, from replacing roofs to new kitchens to bathrooms on a regular cycle. Retrofit itself, Michael, do you have anything to add on that? Because I don't want to comment on something that I don't have the information to front of mind. Yeah. But generically, there is a reinvestment challenge, if I can put it that way.
Yes, in relation to retrofit, specifically to tackle energy efficiency and net zero, George is right that the financial projections show a reduction in the planned investment that landlords would have around existing homes. But also, the vast majority of those plans did not necessarily include the future cost of meeting energy efficiency requirements and net zero, and that's largely because of the ongoing review of the energy efficiency and social housing. That proposal was published last week for the social housing net zero standard. So when that consultation is concluded, landlords will have greater levels of certainty about what the expectations are and the standards that they will have to meet. So we'd expect to see them to start to plan out the costs of delivering on those standards, and we will start to see that come through in the financial projections. Now, we anticipate that will be substantial, the cost of that retrofit. The other uncertainty is at the moment, which I'm sure you will hear from landlords if you speak to them, is what level of public subsidy there may be made available to help them with that exercise in investing in their homes to meet these new standards. So at the moment, there's a degree of uncertainty around that. We do anticipate a substantial investment requirement. Exactly how that will then impact on rent levels for tenants will be in a large part determined by the answer to the question about public subsidy.
Thank you for that, Michael. And my last question, George, again, you've anticipated it, you've answered almost. Obviously, you've got second sight. I think you know what we're going to ask. It was really about the time that landlords are taking to re-let their properties, and you mentioned that it was taking
yes.
longer. But did you pin it on the impact of COVID, the residual impact of COVID?
We hear, if you like, a a mixed economy of answers on that, fair to say. There is a kind of flow through, if you like, from two things. One, there is the availability of the services and the providers to do that. Not all landlords have that in-house. It's often outsourced. Again, there can be a mix. They can use a mix of insourced and outsourced with the same landlord. There are issues that we hear around availability and access to the services to do that. And some of that is about people, frankly, as I understand it, and recruiting the skills and the qualified trades to do that, either themselves or for the outsourced partners. So that's one aspect of that. And that possibly has been a kind of follow-through from the pandemic and the sort of recruitment challenges that we're all hearing about in so many sectors since then. But the second thing is certainly inflation and the costs of these things. And we kind of rehearsed earlier that some of the numbers involved, and I gave you the flavour of the sort of construction and repair inflation that they're seeing. We hear numbers of 10 to 20% from landlords of inflation and these things. So there's that impact too. So I think it's the combination of those two things that we're tending to hear from landlords that are impacting that. There is one other thing, though, actually, I should draw attention to, and that is the final thing we hear is a challenge of getting gas and electricity supplies reconnected in these homes as it goes through that turnover. And we are aware, because I know we've discussed it with them, that the Scottish Government has flagged that at a UK level. Some concerns around that, and that's certainly something that is coming up as an additional challenge. And that's one, of course, that landlords have, you might say, they've got control over what they spend and control over the access to services to a degree. They've no control over that aspect, and that's been a recently emerging one.
As well, there about the loss of income due to the long length, was it 38 million or something? It was
38.7, I think it was.
Landlords can just to
be clear,
attempt to recoup that.
Yes, and that's the lost rent while they sit empty for that period of 56 days on average, as I said.
Any sense from them about how they, or whether they intend to try to recoup that loss?
Well, that's resource that is gone. There's nowhere to recoup it from, if you like. The house is empty. There isn't a tenant in the home that would be due to pay rent. So the longer a home stays empty, the greater that lost rent figure becomes. And that's why we're very aware that landlords work hard to minimise the length of time that a property is empty. Principally so that they can provide a home to somebody as quickly as possible, but also recognising that there is a very significant financial impact on them of having homes that are empty.
It's bound to have an impact on their retrofitting intentions as well, isn't it?
Absolutely, because that's money that is gone from their available resources. So it's another reason why, as you say, they work very hard to try and minimise the length of times that homes are empty. But there are, as George says, there are unquestionably contextual factors that are making that increasingly difficult for landlords. The availability of material and supply, the cost of labour and materials, and some of these other challenges around utility companies and connection of supply. These are making it increasingly difficult for landlords to bear down on the length of time that homes are empty.
Thank you very much for the answers to both of you. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair now, who's joining us online.
Thank you, panel. Obviously, just listening in there, the last bit there, I mean, I know that local authorities have got kind of robust kind of void strategies, but there's huge pressure just now on the HRA accounts. Moving on, obviously, the annual report into the Social Housing Charter shows that tenant satisfaction with quality of their homes has remained around the kind of sort of theme, 84% compared to 85% previously. I wanted to ask what you're doing to ensure you meet your priority around quality of homes and tenant and resident safety. You have touched on it a bit, but I mean, can you expand?
I'm happy to pick up on that one. And landlords' compliance with the Scottish Housing Quality Standard is the principal measure of the quality of the homes that are provided to tenants by social landlords. And landlords' compliance with the Scottish Housing Quality Standard improved between 2021-22 and 22-23 from 73% of all homes meeting the standard to 79%. Now, that is still below the compliance rate that there was prior to 2021, when it sat at 87%. And it's worth saying that most of the homes that fail the Scottish Housing Quality Standard do so on one criteria only. There are a broad range of criteria within the Scottish Housing Quality Standard that homes have to meet. So the vast majority fail on just one. It's less than 4% of homes that fail on more than one criteria. Now, it's also important to flag that the Scottish Housing Quality Standard was amended in the last couple of years to include the requirement for electrical installation condition reports to be carried out every 5 years, and for interlinked smoke and heat detectors to be installed in every home, with compliance targets of March 22 and February 21, respectively. And the decline in the overall compliance levels with the Scottish Housing Quality Standard has principally been because of the challenges landlords have experienced in meeting those target dates. And we know that landlords are continuing to work through the backlog, and that backlog, clear sense that that was impacted by some of the issues we've already touched on in terms of availability of materials and labour as a consequence of all of the economic challenges that we've touched on. And we are engaging with a number of landlords around our compliance levels, and we expect to see full compliance with those particular elements around electrical safety and fire safety when landlords report their performance in the annual return and the charter, which they will give us next year. Just on satisfaction levels, you're right that there was a very small reduction in the overall satisfaction level, but generally the picture shows that almost 9 out of 10 tenants remain satisfied with the homes that their landlord provide with them and with the services that the landlords provide. It is, as I say, it's down ever so slightly to 87%. And we look for landlords to carry out a satisfaction survey at least every 3 years. And in January 23, we updated our advisory guidance on to landlords on surveying their tenants and service users, and that was to include a wider range of approaches that were available to ensure that they have the capacity to reach as many tenants as possible through those satisfaction surveys. Now, just under half of all landlords did surveys in 2022-23. Which means that the figures that we're presenting, have changed on the basis of that volume of surveys having been carried out during that year. Now, there have been some slight decreases in the satisfaction levels in some regards. Tenants satisfied with the quality of their home decreased slightly from 84%. To 84% from 85%. Tenants satisfied that their rent is good value for money decreased slightly to 82% from 81% from 82%. But tenants satisfied with the repair service remained level at 88%. So it's fairly marginal changes in those overall satisfaction levels. And I guess in the context that we've just been describing, you might very well consider that to be a positive outcome.
Thank you for that. In the interest of time, I'll hand back to Campina.
Thanks very much, Marie.
Thank you, Chair. For 2021 to 2022, there were 12,000 incidents of damp and mould recorded in social homes across Scotland. And we heard from earlier on in our previous session, the Ombudsman mentioned that complaints around this issue have quadrupled. So my question is around, do you need to do more work in this area to ensure good practice is widespread and that tenants live in safer homes? And what support should the Scottish Government be offering to ensure that social homes are warm enough to prevent the re-emergence of damp and mould?
I'm happy to kick off on that one. And clearly ensuring that tenants live in safe and warm homes is a critical priority for all social landlords. In December last year, we wrote to all social landlords with advice on the importance of timely and effective action to respond to any incidents of damp and mould. And that's very much in the frame of the requirements around tenant resident safety. In that letter, we asked all governing bodies of RSLs and all committees of councils to consider the systems that they had in place to ensure that their tenants' homes are not affected by damp and mould, and that they have appropriate and proactive systems to identify and deal with any reported cases of damp and mould. Now, following on from that, we worked jointly with the Chartered Institute of Housing, Scottish Federation of Housing Association and the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers to produce a briefing, a note to landlords. This was in February that we published this, on how to ensure that they did deal effectively with damp and mould problems. The briefing recognises the issues are complex and can be multi-layered, and solutions can include tackling issues with the property itself, but also supporting tenants with advice in that regard. Those partner organisations that we worked with to produce that briefing went on to run a series of workshops for landlords to disseminate best practice in responding to incidents of damp and mould. And we know that those were incredibly well attended by landlords. I think indicating how serious landlords take this this issue. We, in July this year, we wrote to social landlords to ask them to include a specific assurance, a specific statement on their compliance with all tenant and resident safety issues, including damp and mould, and that they include that within their annual assurance statement that they provide to us. They provide that statement to us in October, at the end of October every year. We received all of those statements from landlords at the end of October, and we'll use that information, including the specific statements on damp and mould, as part of our risk assessment, which we are now delivering. And we have also published all of those annual assurance statements on our website, so that anyone, including tenants, go and see what their landlord's saying and specifically about their approaches to damp and mould. Now, we'll also fully analyse that information to ensure we've got as good an understanding as possible as the landlord's response to damp and mould. But I think we do recognise that this is a critical issue and we need to go further in terms of data collection. And that's why, as George indicated earlier, we are developing a suite of indicators to include in the annual return in the charter, alongside a wider suite of indicators that will focus on other aspects of tenant resident safety. And we will be consulting in that in the coming year to ensure that we have that as comprehensive as possible suite of indicators that help us understand landlords' response to any reports of damp and mould. We've also asked our tenant advisors, those are tenants who work with us on a voluntary basis to help us scrutinise landlord performance, to look at the information that landlords are putting out on damp and mould for their tenants. And again, when we have that analysis fully done, we'll use that as part of our risk assessment process and reflect any outcomes in that in the published engagement plans we produce for social landlords.
That can I go back in with a supplementary, please?
Just quickly. No, thank you for that.
It's great to hear you're doing so much stuff, but just earlier this year, the UK government brought forward Awab's Law in the memory of, obviously, the two-year-old Awab Ishak, who died in 2020 due to poor housing conditions, to force social landlords to fix damp and mould within the strict limits. Should you think similar legislation be brought forward in Scotland?
That would be a matter for the Scottish Government to consider. What we can say is that the guidance which has put out, we believe, was effective in setting out a good approach that landlords should be taking. And when we develop our suite of indicators, we'll look to ensure that those are capable of assessing appropriately whether those responses are being delivered.
Good. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Pam. We're now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. You've touched upon my question already with regard to the review of the regulatory framework, but I just wondered what the results were from the review of communications with stakeholders and what changes you're looking to bring forward around that.
Okay, I'll pick that one up. The review's going well. We kicked it off, as I touched on my opening statement, we kicked it off in June with a discussion paper in order to get feedback from the sector. Probably the best way I can summarise the broad feedback was that it was very supportive of our thinking, in particular based on two things. Firstly, landlords were saying to us that they would really quite like a period of stability post-pandemic, and thank you very much, regulator, we'd quite like it if you didn't change too much, which seemed not an unfair response to us. But the other thing that came through from landlords, and indeed a whole range of stakeholders, not just landlords, tenants, lenders to the sector as well, was that the framework was working pretty well, in fact. And we agree with that, that the framework has been working pretty well. And so that was the broad, if you like, feedback to the discussion paper that came back. In terms of the specifics, therefore, which is now out to consultation now and closes later this month, and so on. I'll give you a little flavour then of some of those specifics if you like them and what's there. And it isn't a huge amount for reasons I've explained. And that is annual assurance statements. Michael's referred to them a number of times. These were something we introduced in the last framework review, and they have been enormously effective, I need to say, in really getting a finger on the pulse of landlords. And we've even had landlords, and I've sat with chairs and chief executives in various meetings, who have said to me how helpful they found them, and that it's helped them to look into dark corners that maybe in the past they hadn't always looked in. It's just given them a focus. So some adjustment to the annual assurance statements, prompted partly by the discussion we've just been having on damp and mould, actually, to bring aspects such as emerging issues like that into the annual assurance statement each year. But clearly we've signalled in that we would give landlords time to prepare for that. You know, we're not about to announce in September we'd like something in damp mould in October. They were very clear they'd like notice. So some adjustments to annual assurance statements to allow that. Some specific changes to the language around our regulatory status. By regulatory status, I mean the language I have at the moment is working towards compliant. There's an in-review category, and there's within statutory intervention category. And we've made some adjustments to that language, primarily around the language of working towards compliance, that was actually very important to lenders and to tenants. They felt there was just some vagueness there, and the language wasn't helpful. We've made that there. And then we've touched on the fact that we wanted to develop the suite of metrics around damp and mould, that Michael's touched on. We didn't want to take a kind of a, you know, sledgehammer to crack a nut on that, hence this collaborative approach we're taking with the sector, both in the advice that was developed, but on the suite. And then we've expanded that out into the ARC, the annual return. And so we're kicking that off with a series of working groups involving landlords and others to do that. Normally, we would have made that part of the framework review itself, but partly because of the timing of the new government regulations, the new consultation around the replacement of EASH, published recently, we wanted to combine those two things together. So that's the final part of that. And so that will be ongoing rather than implementable from the 1st of April in terms of that. So that's probably the overview summary I can give you. But actually, we're really quite pleased that the because we made very significant changes to the framework last time around, that that has been working well, and that's what we hear from landlords too. And as a regulator, it's actually fairly unusual that those whom you regulate come to you and say, actually, it is working quite well. You made lots of changes, and we don't really believe you need to change lots more. And we agree with that, and maybe the evidence for that is how well the annual assurance statement element is working, and the fact that we have, although we're in discussions with an engagement with a number of landlords at the moment, as you would expect, there are no statutory interventions taking place. And I think I'm right in saying actually our last one closed in a number of years ago, 2021, wasn't it? Yes, I was hesitating on the year there because I couldn't quite remember. Michael's just pointed out in 21. So I think that's maybe evidence of why we're hearing what we are hearing from landlords, lenders and tenants across the board.
No, that's helpful, thank you. You'll be aware the housing bill the government signalled will include new homelessness duties placed on. Has that also been part of the communication with stakeholders to preempt that coming in, which would be a statutory a piece of legislation? And will cross public services accept that? But I just wondered where work was starting already on that.
I'm happy to be a component of that, Yeah, we've been working closely with the Scottish Government around its plans to bring forward the proposed new duties on prevention of homelessness in particular. And we will ensure that the approach we take to setting out a regulatory framework is such that it can accommodate changes in legislation as they come through. So we're very excited on what is being proposed, and where there are duties that are brought in and placed on social landlords by the proposals around prevention, then we will ensure that we monitor their delivery of any of those new duties that are brought in.
That's great. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks, Miles. I've got a question here that kind of connects to the regulatory review, and I'd be interested to hear how you deal with complaints about how you've dealt with regulatory matters, and also if you think that some social landlord staff may be unwilling to raise complaints with you.
That's hard for me to say as to whether people are unwilling to raise complaints. We certainly get complaints from time to time, and we have a very clear process all laid out on our website as to how we how we handle that, I would say. I suppose that I'd point to a number of things, and is that we have extensive engagement across the sector, including with a number of landlord groups. So that we're engaging with at any one time, what about a third of landlords? We have three live groups that engage with us. One was an existing group pre-pandemic, the systemically important landlord group, they were called. We then have two new ones that we introduced when we called out to the sector to ask if they'd be willing to get involved in this, if you like, to up our engagement even further post-pandemic. We plan to introduce a second group, but the response is so significant. We got 70 landlords, I think it was, wanting to join us. We ended up establishing two further groups in addition to refreshing the systemically important one. One was focusing on those landlords operating in urban areas, and the other was for more remote rural and island areas, because sometimes the challenges that they tackle can be different. So about a third. They certainly engage with us on a regular basis. Do they raise issues with and concerns in those discussions? They do. Does that result in specific complaints? Rarely, but certainly things can come up with those. So I think that we have a very open relationship there within that. In terms of what we try to do, we certainly work very hard to be an effective and an open and transparent regulator. And in terms of any specific concerns about how we regulate, and I suppose, convener, how that applies in particular in statutory interventions, we have a very clear complaints process that can be taken up at any time, as laid out on our website. And there's a route, of course, to the Ombudsman, who I think you were just hearing from before us, as it happens, but a route through to the Ombudsman. And that has happened at least once recently that I can think of. but not commonly. So that's certainly there. In terms of use of statutory powers, we've used statutory powers 12 times since 2012, so not a very significant number over 10, 11 years. And we go out of our way to publish a final report and be very transparent on why that intervention was required and so on and so forth. And the bit I would want to ensure the committee on in terms of that is that we don't take statutory interventions lightly or enter them lightly. That typically only happens after quite a significant period, usually multi-months of engagement. And in fact, it's only really where a landlord either can't, or I'll be honest, in some cases won't, engage to tackle the issues that we're raising, that statutory powers are used. So I think that, in summary, would be how I would answer that, that we try to be as open as we can be. We certainly encourage people to come and talk to us, and they do. And that might be individual issues that feed up through tenants, through the tenant liaison committee of the RTOs that we meet with regularly, and Michael and I are at each of their meetings for a period of time, through to the various landlord groups that we have, and sometimes with the membership and professional bodies that are around. I won't name them, you know the ones. So that's the approach that we take, but certainly we're very open to concerns, complaints, or anything else that come to us, and we're very transparent on what the routes can be taken, both internally to us and externally to the Ombudsman, to take things like that forward.
Okay, thanks very much. That was very helpful. I'm now going to bring in Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks, gentlemen. How does the Scottish Housing Regulator's oversight of the loss of several community-controlled housing associations to takeovers by large national housing groups square with the Scottish Government's community wealth building and empowerment missions?
Well, we regulate individual landlords, and we don't have any kind of sectoral role, or we have no remit from Parliament to effect sectoral change or restructuring or consolidation. So the role given to us by Parliament is to monitor, assess and report on landlords' performance and to intervene as appropriate. And we are an effective regulator doing the job that Parliament has given us to do, and will continue to do that job in a proportionate and risk-based manner. So that job that Parliament has given us to do is to ensure that we protect the interests of tenants and others who use the services of social landlords, and in particular to monitor their performance against the Scottish Social Housing Charter and against the regulatory standards of governance and financial management. That's the extent of our role. So we do that role, we monitor, we report, and we intervene where there are failures against any of those three elements. As I say, that's the job that Parliament has given us to do. We believe we are an effective regulator in doing that.
Do you not think that community control of asset wealth is in tenants' interests?
All I can say is that we deliver our role against assessing landlord performance in relation to those things that are set out in the Scottish Social Housing Charter and in the regulatory standards of finance and financial management and governance. Those are the things which we are tasked with monitoring landlord performance on. Now, if those had different things in them, different requirements, different specifications, then we would monitor, assess and report and intervene in accordance with those requirements that were set out. So we're doing the job that's been set by Parliament for us to do, and we believe we are doing that effectively.
Just to be clear with your point here, do you agree that the current remit of the Scottish Housing Regulator isn't adequate to safeguard community control of assets?
The remit of the Scottish Housing Regulator set by Parliament.
Standard 7.3 in the SHR's Regulatory Framework Standards of Governance and Financial Management states that a registered social landlord must ensure an adequate consultation before engaging in an options appraisal. So why was this not done at Readvale Housing Association in Glasgow? And when this was reported to the Scottish Housing Regulator, no action was taken, and the Housing Association were allowed to carry out a consultation post-appraisal, but which had already predetermined that there should be a transfer of engagements currently owned by the community to another housing association, assets which are valued conservatively over £100 million and with no debt secured against those assets?
Well, I mean, the first thing I would say is that we're quite happy to meet with the member to discuss his specific concerns about a specific organisation. Always happy to do that with any MSP. Obviously, I'm conscious there's a lot in the specifics of what you raised there. What I can say is that we engaged early with Reid Vale in its considerations of a possible transfer, and we highlighted the importance to Reid Vale of it engaging with tenants on proposals, and we expected them to carry out effective consultation with their tenants. Reid Vale then developed a detailed tenant consultation plan and commissioned the Tenant Information Service as an independent tenant advisor, and that's a requirement which we placed on them. We've engaged closely with Reid Vale to get appropriate assurances about how it was consulting its tenants, and that tenants have been given meaningful opportunities to feed into the transfer proposals and to give their views. And of course, at the end of the day, tenants will have a vote in this. That vote is ongoing at the moment, and we will expect Reid Vale to abide by the outcome of that tenant vote.
Of course, at that stage, the precondition for transfer had already been set, and obviously the regulator has a role in overseeing these processes. In the case of Reid Vale, we know that Places for People Group, a London-based organisation, have been present at Reid Vale's AGM, have posted promotional material on Reid Vale's own website, have sent targeted literature to tenants, put up signage in the area, and struck a deal to take over a community centre owned by Reid Vale Housing Association after the Housing Association withdrew funding for it. Do you think that this sort of aggressive and insidious lobbying is appropriate?
We will ensure that tenants have that opportunity to vote on any proposal that's set in front of them, and we will expect Reid Vale to abide by that tenant vote.
Thank you, Convener. I've observed 18 separate regulatory breaches, conflicts of interest and procedural abuses by the Interim Director and Management Committee, co-optees at Reid Vale Housing Association, which I've written to you about today, along with other members of Parliament. If a potential transfer partner has breached data protection law by obtaining the personal contact information of the target housing association's tenants to canvass them without their explicit consent, with unsolicited text messages and calls, what action would the Scottish Housing Regulator take in this instance?
I think what I would say is thank you for writing to us. We'll take any of that information under consideration to identify whether there have been any failures in the part of Reid Vale or any other party to the transfer. And I'll say again, very happy to meet with you to discuss those concerns.
OK. Well, I very much thank you for answering my questions and look forward to further discussion. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thanks very much.
Can I just add?
Yes.
What Michael said, because I just want to reassure the member, Mr Sweeney, that how the board looks at this, because you asked very direct questions around your support for community control. The board's completely agnostic. And I can tell you, two very strong tenants on our board who wouldn't let us be otherwise, by the way, if we wanted to be. The board is completely agnostic about structures or ownership. What we're interested in is fulfilling our statutory duty, which is to protect the interests of tenants. And therefore, what the board has looked at, and the board has been very well cited on what's going on at Reid Vale, are the issues that may affect tenant interest. And just to give you a flavour of what these are at Reid Vale, there were and there remain serious governance and financial management weaknesses at Reid Vale. There's no business plan. There's no up-to-date stock condition survey. There's no long-term investment programme. We've now established that many of its homes require significant investment, and in its most recent annual assurance statement, it said that it cannot meet its investment requirements. It told us that we'd need to significantly raise rents in order to, and to borrow, in order to fund the necessary investments to maintain its homes. To give you a sense of what that means, what they're telling us is they need to raise rents by 5% in year one and 10% a year thereafter in order to fund these things. There are very high overheads well beyond the overheads that we see at other landlords, salaries that are higher than are being paid at other landlords. The organisation has not managed its resources to ensure its financial well-being or the assessment of or its financial position. There were serious weaknesses in the governing body, and it's currently having to rely heavily on the support of voluntary co-options. They told us of weaknesses in their organisational structure, their pensions approach, their commercial assets and investment requirements. There are examples where it has not received remuneration for commercial properties which it's rented or given to organisations to use at no cost. The rent increase last year, for some of these reasons I've explained, as you might expect, is amongst the highest across social landlords at 6%. And a recent internal audit has reported very weak assurance in the delivery of the factoring role. And so in terms of what the board of SHR worries about in an organisation like this, it's those things and how those things will in the long run affect and impact tenants rather than structures, local control and so on. So I just wanted to reassure you, A, that the board of the regulator is very cited on this and is very closely briefed, as I am personally, but also what it is that is on our agenda when we discuss an organisation such as Reid Vale, because I know that you want to understand, you know, what role a board would play and what would be on our agenda for that, and that is the role that the board plays, and looking at this kind of list of concerns that there are around Reid Vale. That's not to say that community ownership isn't a good thing and an important thing, but what matters most is that Reid Vale can deliver for its tenants.
If I may come back briefly, convener, I appreciate the challenges in governance which you've outlined and which I've been cited on as well. But what I would note is that the fundamental is that this is 900 tenements in a highly desirable part of Glasgow and with no debt secured against them, which is quite unusual for a housing association to have that level of fiscal headroom to raise capital through secured debt against the properties. Furthermore, there hasn't seemed to be any proactive efforts to support the community to improve the governance of the housing association without having to surrender control of the assets. And also that several professionals who are engaged in community-controlled housing associations across the Glasgow area offered to come into the housing associations to support the restructuring without having to surrender control of the assets to a large national housing group, but were denied and blocked by the Scottish Housing Regulator. So those are matters of concern, I understand, in terms of co-options onto that board. And in light of that and what you've said today, certainly it's a matter for us to consider how we strengthen protections for community-controlled housing in Scotland. So thank you very much. Cheers.
Very much. Yes, certainly, as you say, if we have a community empowerment agenda, maybe that is something that we do need to be looking at. But it was also very helpful to hear that the board of the Scottish Housing Regulator has a very specific, clear remit to look after the interests of tenants. So how do we do tenants and community is something that we should take away. So thank you so much for coming in and giving your evidence today. I think it's been very helpful to hear about the work of your work over the last year and obviously the challenging landscape that social landlords and tenants are living and working in. And I now briefly suspend the meeting for a change of our witnesses. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 4, which is to take evidence on the council tax variation for unoccupied dwellings, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023, from Tom Arthur, who's the Minister for Community, Wealth and Public Finance of the Scottish Government. And Mr. Arthur is joined for this item by Scottish Government officials, Heather Galbraith, who's a solicitor, James Missis, who is the Council Tax Policy Lead, and Jessica Niven, who is the unit head at the More Homes Division. And I welcome the Minister and his officials to the meeting and invite him to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. The draft instrument under consideration has a purpose which is twofold. Firstly, it is intended to provide councils with discretion over the council tax treatment of second homes. If introduced, it will enable councils to charge second homes up to a 100% premium. This instrument also seeks to allow councils to grant a six-month grace period from the 100% empty homes council tax premium, which is aimed at incentivising the reoccupation of empty homes. These regulations seek to deliver both changes with effect from 1st April 2024. In the spirit of the Verity House Agreement, both of the policies contained in this instrument have been developed in partnership with local government. Last year, I convened the Joint Working Group on Sources of Local Government Funding and Council Tax Reform, which is co-chaired by Scottish Ministers Anne Cosler. This group has considered and endorsed the final policies within the instrument. In April of this year, we published a consultation in partnership with Cosler on the council tax treatment of second and long-term empty homes. That consultation sought views on giving discretionary powers to local authorities to increase the rate of council tax on second and empty homes. A 100% council tax premium on second homes received majority support from respondents to the consultation. The discretion to apply to second homes a discount up to 50% or a premium up to 100% ensures parity with the treatment of long-term empty properties. If implemented, the discretionary power would put councils front and centre in deciding how to achieve the right balance in the use of housing to meet local needs, enabling them, where necessary, to encourage more residential accommodation to be in occupation and used as homes for living in. This is consistent with our intention set out in the Verity House Agreement to provide greater flexibilities to local government. It also dovetails with the Scottish Government's Housing to 2040 strategy, which commits to providing local authorities with greater discretion to encourage greater occupancy of second homes. And I should also note that the UK Government has very recently legislated to provide councils in England with the same 100% council tax premium on empty homes. Turning to the empty homes grace period contained within the instrument, this issue was considered by the Joint Working Group following the publication of an independent audit report on the effectiveness of Scotland's long-term empty homes policy produced by Indigo House. That report recommended that the council tax premium for empty homes could better incentivise empty homes back into use. Reflecting on this recommendation, in partnership with Cosler, we agreed that a council tax premium on empty homes could be a disincentive to the delivery of bringing empty homes back into use when a long-term empty property changes hands after a sale. These regulations provide for a six-month exclusion from the 100% council tax premium where a long-term empty property is purchased by a new owner and renovations or repairs are being undertaken. Local authorities will have discretion to extend that six-month grace period. This measure would prevent the empty home council tax premium from becoming a deterrent to new ownership. To conclude, the draft regulations that were laid before the Parliament deliver on our commitment to a fairer housing and taxation system. They empower local authorities to make decisions about the council tax treatment of second homes to determine the balance in the use of housing to meet local needs. They recognise that local areas differ across the country and what may cause pressure in some communities could equally provide a benefit to others. Other than that, Convener, I will conclude and I hope that members will agree to support the instrument today.
Thanks very much for that introduction. I'd just be interested to hear your thoughts on why you think a council tax premium of 100% may encourage second home owners to use the accommodation differently for benefit of local communities, for example, by making their property available for long-term rent. And do you understand the typology of second homeowners enough to determine whether this would be effective?
Well, I think the questions you raise get to the heart of why this is a discretionary power for local government, who are best placed to determine whether or not tax measures can be utilised in a way to support their policy objectives, recognising, as I pointed out in my introductory remarks, that second homes in some areas may be making a positive contribution. Equally, in other areas, it may be the view of local authorities that they are causing pressures, and a way of helping to address that in tandem with other policy levers at the disposal of local authority would be to use these discretionary powers. So we very much recognise that this is a decision for local authorities to be informed by their expertise with regards to what their local priorities are and what the best way to address them is.
Thanks for that, and certainly underscoring the intentions in the Verity House agreement. So in Wales, councils have been able to, as we know, charge a council tax premium on second homes of up to 100% since 2017. And then since April 2023, they can charge a premium of up to 300%. And I'd be interested to hear if you've considered the implementation of that policy in Wales. I understand there is a consultation on second and empty homes around raising it to 200%, but 300%, and what lessons can be learned for Scotland?
Well, as I'm sure the committee appreciates, these are relatively recent changes in Wales, but we continue to have dialogue at official level, as you would expect, with the Welsh Government and indeed with our colleagues in the UK Government. We will, of course, monitor with interest developments in Wales as more evidence becomes available. As you highlighted, as part of our consultation, we also posed the question as to whether there should be the option to go beyond a 100% premium, and that is something we are reflecting on further as part of the ongoing work of the Joint Working Group.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. Thanks for joining us. I wondered what consideration had been taken in by the government with regards to the argument that's been put to committee that people with second homes are not using public services to the same extent as permanent residents and may have already as well paid additional dwelling supplement on land and building transaction tax.
Well, again, these will be matters to be determined by a local authority. What this power provides is for is something that is discretionary, and of course there are existing powers that local authorities have to apply a discount. So it would really be a question for an individual local authority in recognising that the decision is ultimately taken by elected members who are democratically accountable to the people who live within that local authority. So we recognise that there may well be a range of views within a particular area, but I would note the broad support that was received for the proposals within the consultation, and indeed from the evidence that the committee has taken from some local authorities already, recognising at least at this stage an intention to explore the utilisation of these powers.
And can I ask, have government also considered other mechanisms which would be available, which could be used to incentivise second homers to use their homes differently, for example, conditional grant schemes or leasing schemes? And was that part of the consultation as well?
The consultation focused very much specifically on the provisions that we're considering today and the other matters that I made reference to, and also some potential ancillary issues around non-domestic rates, as you will be aware of as well. That was part of the overall package of proposals that were considered in the consultation. There clearly is a range of work underway across local government and national government with regards to increasing the supply of housing that is available. What I would say is that, and recognise that there's no one single policy which will act as a solution to all of the challenges that we currently face, but this is one tool that will become available should Parliament agree to it as a discretionary power to local authorities. And I say it will be for local authorities to consider the utilisation of this discretionary power in that broader context of policy tools that they have at their disposal.
Okay, thanks for that. In terms of the policy's impact, it's been quite clear government have said this is to bring more homes into full-time long-term let. I don't see anything from Wales to suggest any numbers of that policy actually being delivered. So this is perhaps more in terms of tax raising revenue for councils. I think the government's estimating £35 million potentially. Is that your reading of this, that there aren't statistics of how many additional new homes at long-term let homes this will provide, so this is just another stream of revenue for councils?
I think it's again back to that point about seeing it being utilised within a broader context of policy interventions. Tax can play a role. We set out within our framework for tax that we published some 2 years ago, the various functions of the tax system. That can include, for example, revenue raising, promoting behavioural change, economic stimulus, redistribution. Now, clearly, revenue raising will always be a consideration in any tax policy it's taken, but behavioural change is also an aspect of tax policy consideration. So, again, in terms of the actual particular circumstances, that will be for local authorities to determine. As I say, this is a completely discretionary power, and it will be for local authorities to decide based upon their local understanding of the priorities in the area, whether or not to use it.
Thanks. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Tom, are you concerned at all about any possible behavioural response to the measure in that second homeowners might shift their properties into the short-term letting domain, making them liable for non-domestic rates and thereby potentially not paying anything at all?
Well, again, this will be, in a broader sense, something that, of course, we will continue to monitor and keep under review. And that will, again, be, coming back to this point, I appreciate, a consideration for local authorities in terms of what monitoring any behavioural response takes place. And in doing so, reassessing whether or not any policy decision they take in utilising this power is having the desired effect. As more broadly with regards to the existing threshold for non-domestic rates, this was obviously something that we considered as part of a consultation, but we do recognise that the existing thresholds are relatively new, and as such we would not be proposing to make any changes at this stage, and rather allowing for that to further bed in.
Yeah, I mean, it was certainly raised by Councillor Loban, I think, at previous meetings about the potential for that to happen. You've just touched on the second part of my question there, really, about the consultation, the potential to increase it beyond 100%. Did we give consideration to that and rule that out?
That is something that the Joint Working Group is giving consideration to as part of its broader programme of work. What I would note is to move beyond what is within these regulations would require primary legislation. But as I say, at this particular point, the Joint Working Group is carefully reflecting and considering what emerged through the consultation and consultation analysis.
Okay, thanks for that. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. And just on the legislative change, how would you be monitoring the impact of it? And do you think there's sufficient data being captured which would indicate in the future if it's having the intended impact on improving availability of housing?
Well, clearly we could continue to engage with local authorities. Local authorities will have, should Parliament agree to this instrument being passed, the option to introduce this measure from the 1st of April next year. I recognise that some local authorities are actively considering that. So clearly there would need to be a period of time before we could be in a position to assess what impact such policy intervention was having in a particular local authority, and also to consider the impact within the various geographies of a local authority and also the impact in different local authorities. So we would consider that over time. Local authorities, of course, would be monitoring it in terms of the efficacy of the policy, and clearly through our continued engagement and dialogue as per the Verity House Agreement, we would, and a joint working group for that matter as well, that would provide a forum. But I think we would all recognise that any local authority introducing this in April of next year, we would need to allow some time before making any initial assessments. But of course, there will be ongoing engagement and dialogue throughout that process.
Okay, thanks for that. And Pam Goethal.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, officials. My question is around, I've been speaking to councils in relation to this coming forward, and some of the councils have said that they, of course, they will raise a substantial amount additional in revenue from additional taxes, but some have said that they will raise nothing from this, and maybe some with much less as well. Has the Minister considered that this may create a huge disparity between different council areas, and does the Minister have any expectations how the revenue generated should be spent, and should it be ring-fenced or not?
Okay, on the latter point, we are, through the joint working group, engaging with COSLA around joint guidance in that particular space. More broadly, in terms of the disparity that will exist between councils, that will
obviously be a factor of the relative number of second homes within different local authorities, but also come down to whether or not a local authority chooses to utilise these powers. And clearly there can be a number of different factors that will bear upon that decision for a local authority to make. So we will continue to engage, as I touched on with my previous question, with local authorities to monitor and understand any impacts that are observed with regards to the policy itself, and also how that relates to revenue individual local authorities are raising.
Just on the ring fence, is there anything on? I know obviously that you know, the Verity House agreements going to relax a lot of, hopefully, ring fencing for local authorities. So can I ask on this area, that are you proposing to ring fence this money to be spent in certain ways, or is it completely up to the local authority if, one, they take it on, and, two, how they spend it?
We would want to have that discretion and flexibility consistent with the existing premium on empty homes to apply to this. But as I say, we're committed to engaging with COSLA and DIAL around joint guidance. But we do recognise that this is a discretionary power for local authorities, and as such, that we will have we want an approach for it in terms of how the revenue is used to be consistent with that discretion.
Thanks. And I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ministers and officials. Minister and your officials. The regulations also pose a grace period from the application of premiums for new owners of empty homes where repairs and renovations are being undertaken. How does this proposal fit with your wider audit of empty homes, and what progress has been made on it?
Well, this is a demonstrative of our commitment to, you know, addressing issues. Well, to utilising all the powers at our disposal in progression of our wider ambitions around Housing 2040. This was something that was identified via the housing audit I referred to in my opening statement, that the 100% premium on empty homes could act as a disincentive for those purchasing empty homes. So this helps to address that as through that six-month grace period. There is also the discretion that is available for local authorities as well to, you know, extend that period, but that would be a matter for individual local authorities.
Thank you for that. Can you back to yourself?
Thanks, Marie. Okay. Oh, Miles.
On that point, with regards to a grace period, I think it's important, but I just wondered why there isn't a formal process beyond that. You've suggested councils will have to have individual discussions with developers or individuals who are trying to bring back empty homes. That will create a postcode lottery if each council then has a different process, different ruling potentially. And just wondered, for those who we're trying to encourage to bring empty properties back, and 47,000 have been pointed towards, that leaves it very open to councils then deciding whether or not 6 months taken as a cut-off, or genuinely case-by-case, who would be doing that work?
I can understand the premise of the question. I think there is always inherent within empowering local authorities, and to have that discretion, variation will be part of that, but it will be a matter for local authorities to determine. I know that, you know, it's a shared ambition with local authorities to ensure we're bringing as many empty homes back into use as possible, and I'm sure that will inform part of the decision-making process that local authorities to take. But with regards to the discretionary elements right across the board that we've been discussing today, these are matters for local authorities to take into account, and they ultimately do reflect the fact that local authorities are democratically accountable to their electorates. James, will you want to come in with any further points?
Yes, yeah, so within the policy note, there's a commitment to establish joint guidance with local government so that there is a sort of more standardised approach about what we mean by repairs and renovations, citing examples. But as the Minister's said, I mean, there are individual circumstances that require a single perspective, a case-by-case assessment. For example, someone that's undertaking repairs and renovations that go beyond 6 months might indeed get in touch with their local authority to request the grace period to be extended to accommodate that.
Yeah, that's helpful. And for any of us who watch TV programmes, we can understand sometimes where these expected timescales slip. And so I think it's that flexibility within the guidelines is really important. I think Edinburgh City Council told us recently, as Edinburgh MSPs, it takes up to 8 months to bring a council-owned property back. That's the period of works they expect. I think it's important that guidance provides that flexibility going forward. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, Miles, for seeking that bit of detail there. And that concludes our question. So I'd like to thank the Minister and his officials for the evidence you've given today. And we now turn to agenda item 5, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M11186, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Council Tax Variation for Unoccupied Dwellings Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. Do members have any points that they wish to make? No points? No points. The question is that motion S6M11186 in the name of Tom Arthur be approved. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. So there will be a division. Those in favour of the motion, please raise their hands. Maria, you'll have to raise your hand or do whatever you're going to do. Yes, thank you. Okay. And those against? No one against. And those abstaining? Okay. And the result of the division is for the motion, 3, against the motion, 0, and abstentions, 2. The motion is therefore agreed. What do we do now? So thank you. The committee will publish a report setting out its recommendation on the instrument in the coming days and will now briefly suspend to allow the minister and his officials to leave before we move on to the next item. Thank you.